Good morning. My name is Adedeji. I am Professor Adedeji's son. Here represents him at this occasion in his honor. First of all, I must, on behalf of the family, once again thank Dr. Carlos Lopez for the honor he has done my father in setting up this Adebayo Adedeji lecture series. When I was invited to come here again, I was present at the launch in Abuja of the lecture series. I called to inform my father that Dr. Lopez had asked me to come to Abuja for this lecture. And I remember distinctly what he said when I was leaving, was that, yes, when you get there, please say as little as possible so you do not let them know that I unfortunately have a lawyer for a son. So I do not think there's much more I can add to what Dr. Lopez has said, and I do not think there's anything I can improve on the excellent lecture that Dr. Chang is going to deliver. So with that, I ask you all to please join me in welcoming Dr. Chang to the podium to deliver his excellent lecture. Thank you.
Well, thank you, everyone, for coming to listen to this lecture. It is my great honor to give this lecture named after Professor Adedeji, who was really an intellectual and political beacon during the darkest times in the post-colonial history of Africa and other developing regions. I mean, he has explored so many important issues, and you know, I am covering only a subset of that in today's lecture. So I approach this with some trepidation. Before I begin, I would like to present some of my books to Professor Adedeji through Doin, because he cannot be here, and I very much want to kind of show him his intellectual legacy. Right, let me start my lecture by talking about a couple of typical developing countries. Let's call them country A and B for the moment. Well, country A, like most other developing countries, is dependent on what nature has given to it. It has a lot of land and therefore relies on exporting agricultural products. It has a lot of potential for mining, but the infrastructure is really poor, so it is not well developed. The country also has high wages, especially compared to those manufacturing nations in the East. So people agree that it's difficult to develop manufacturing. This wage issue was so important that one of the country's founding fathers actually called for protectionism in order to protect local wages against Eastern competition. And given this situation, a lot of people became very worried when the new finance minister has just produced a major policy document advocating a typical import substitution industrialization strategy based on high tariffs, subsidies, and government investments in infrastructural projects. His critics love to cite the world-famous British economist who about 15 years ago explicitly warned the country not to try to artificially industrialize, because it's going to hamper the progress of the country. Country B, well, like country A, is also dependent on natural resources too. Over 80% of its exports are in natural resources, like tungsten ore and fish. But unfortunately, unlike country A, it is not very well endowed with natural resources, so it is one of the poorest countries in the world, with a per capita income less than half that of Ghana's. With a literacy ratio just over 70%, and cultural aversion to professions like engineering and business is a prospect for diversifying out of natural resources through industrialization is considered very low. Moreover, the country has just emerged from a bloody fratricidal war barely a decade ago. Partly because of that, the country is famous for political divisions, corruption, and administrative incompetence. This is why an internal memo of the USAID several years back had described the country as a bottomless pit. Given the circumstances, the recent government announcement that it is going to set up a huge state-owned steel plant in a country that doesn't even produce iron ore has been duly received with widespread skepticism inside and outside the country, including by the World Bank. Well, typical stories, you know, this could be from anywhere in the developing world, Africa, Latin America, the poorer parts of Asia, except that country A is the United States of America in 1791, and country B is South Korea in 1965. This is how the descriptions would have read if I had given you the full information. So yes, the US was in those days dependent on export of agricultural products like cotton and tobacco. They were really worried that the lower wages in European nations were undermining wages in their own country. It was Benjamin Franklin who advocated protectionism in order to protect local wages against low wage competition from the countries in the East, namely the European countries. And the report that I was referring to was the report submitted to the US Congress by the US Treasury Secretary, or what do they been called, the finance minister in other countries, Alexander Hamilton, who is someone who you have seen many times, but I haven't quite realized who he is. Yeah? It's the guy on the $10 bill. Yeah? Yeah, and it's quite amazing, you know. I mean, the Americans think he's so important that he's the only non-president who is on the U.S. dollar bill, of course, except for Benjamin Franklin, who is, you know, the USA's, you know, the great statesman. But people don't know what policy he was advocating. Oops. Yeah, and the British economist who warned the Americans not to industrialize was none other than Adam Smith, who in his great book, The Wealth of Nations, explicitly said, please don't do this. Yeah? This is the full quote. Yeah? As for South Korea, it is true that until the mid-1960s, half of its income was less than half that of Ghana's. Over 80% of its exports were in natural resources like tungsten ore, fish, seaweed. Except that it had so few of those that its living standard was really pathetic. Yeah? These days, people think this East Asian culture called Confucian culture is a great culture for economic development. And I don't know how many of you have seen that, but there's this book called Culture Matters, edited by Samuel Huntington, which has all these articles saying, you know, Ghana didn't develop because it had wrong culture, Korea developed because it had the right culture, respecting education, you know, emphasizing hard work. All of those might be true, But this culture also had the deep disdain for practical pursuits, huh? Because the ruling class in that culture is a scholar bureaucrat. Yeah? So anyone who had a half a brain wanted to become a lawyer or economist, work for the government. No one wanted to become an engineer. Yeah? No one wanted to run business. Yeah? You know, some people think civil war is the African speciality, but no, I mean, we had one back in the 1950s. No, I mean, in 3 years, 4 million people were killed. Yeah? In the case of South Korea, I mean, not to speak of North Korea, which is bombed flat by the Americans. In the case of South Korea, we lost half of what little manufacturing capacity we had. We lost 75% of railways. This created a huge material gaps, but also political divisions, administrative incompetence, any number of things. I think it was totally justified for the USAID to call the country a bottomless pit in the late 1950s, because it was during that decade pouring money into South Korea and nothing very much was happening. And that story about the steel mill is the famous company called POSCO, which is now the fourth largest steel manufacturer in the world. But when back in 1965, the South Korean government announced that it's going to set up this steel mill, I mean, everyone thought they were crazy. Huh? This was a time in South Korea that the income was not even 5% of the US income. Yeah? So many economists pointed out that the country doesn't have comparative advantage in this capital-intensive industry like steel. Yeah? And as I mentioned earlier, it doesn't even produce iron ore, yeah? No coking coal, which are the two the key ingredients in producing steel. If it was today, it could have imported those things from China, but this was at the height of the Cold War. There was no trade between South Korea and China at all. Yeah? So where was the nearest place that they could import those things? Australia, yeah? 6,000 miles away. Yeah? And the government says, we are going to set it up as a state-owned enterprise because no private sector enterprise is willing to do this. And in order to make it viable, we have to make it a statutory monopoly. People said, you must be out of your mind. You are going against every single economic wisdom that is there. Yeah, so that naturally, the World Bank refused to endorse this proposal when South Korea was seeking loans from Western donors. I mean, they eventually built it with the sort of colonial reparation money from Japan, but you know, I mean, everyone thought that this was the craziest industrial project you can imagine. Hmm? So, what happened? How come these countries that were in their respective times, no different from typical developing countries in Africa today, have become two of the most successful economies in human history? Well, the short answer is that these two countries industrialized against the advice from Adam Smith and the World Bank. Now, of course, we all know the limitations of relying on primary commodities. We all know what the special benefits manufacturing can provide, but let me just repeat some of these because they are very important things. So first of all, when you rely on the primary commodities, you have the well-known and the well-proven phenomenon of the long-term decline in the terms of trade against manufactured products. Secondly, primary commodities have a very high price volatility. As many African nations are experiencing today, you know, when these prices crash, it becomes very difficult to manage your balance of payments, your government budget, because the tax revenue collapses, and it becomes very difficult to have any long-term plan, both at the national and at the corporate level, because you don't know what your revenue will be in the next few years. Thirdly, countries that rely on primary commodities are also vulnerable to technological shocks from innovation by the more advanced countries. You know, when the British and the Germans invented organic chemistry, a lot of economies went into crisis. Chile and Peru, which were earning quite a nice income by exporting things like bird guano as a fertilizer, or saltpeter, key ingredient in the gunpowder, or the Guatemala, which had a sort of near world monopoly in this very highly priced dye called cochineal. All of their economies went into crisis and didn't recover for decades. So even if you are earning good money from your natural resources, there's always the danger that someone who has superior technology will come up with a synthetic alternative, and your income will be wiped out. These are all well known, but people have forgotten them. Also, manufacturing possesses some special characteristics which make it very important for economic development. Well, first of all, it is much more conducive to raising productivity. First of all, it is much less bound by nature. You know, for example, that Adam Smith in his Wealth of Nations started his book with this example of a pin factory, in which he said, if a single person is trying to make a pin, maybe he can make one pin a day, maybe 20 pins a day, because there are a lot of processes. You have to draw the wire, cut the wire, sharpen the wire, attach the head, and so on. And it becomes very slow. But he said that if you divide it into, say, 10 steps and employ 10 people, they can actually produce thousands of pins. Actually, a couple of hundred years later, a Cambridge economist called Cliff Pratton visited actual pin factories and figured out how much the productivity of pin production had increased. And basically, to give you a perspective, this was the increase in the order of thousands of times. So if the productivity increase in the pin industry happened exactly in growing wheat, it means that we could be growing wheat in 6 minutes instead of 6 months. Now, he said almost impossible to achieve that kind of productivity growth in agriculture because it's bound by nature, even though you can overcome quite a lot of it through technologies. Many service activities are by nature impervious to productivity growth. To give you the most extreme example, if there's a string quartet piece that lasts 27 minutes, you cannot say that, well, the players would run through it in 9 minutes, and you say that the productivity has increased by three times. No, I mean, it'll actually ruin the product. So 27-minute string quartet performance has close to zero productivity growth. So a lot of service activities are like that. I mean, all of this is basically because manufacturing activities lend themselves much more easily to mechanization and chemical processing. So it has inherently faster productivity growth. Secondly, Economic historians have called the manufacturing sector the learning center of the economy, the point being that the manufacturing sector produces inputs that other sectors can use to increase productivity. So it produces the capital goods, namely machines, transport equipment, and things like that, and other intermediate goods like chemical fertilizer. Yeah? And in this way, it spreads technological progress to other sectors. Thirdly, the manufacturing sector is also the main source of organizational innovation. You know, a lot of the increase in the productivity in services have become possible because those industries adopted not just the sort of machines produced by the manufacturing sector, but also the organization techniques in the manufacturing sector. So modern inventory management techniques first developed in the manufacturing sector are now widely used in the retail sector. You know, in the McDonald's and other fast food restaurants, they're applying the assembly technique, which was initially developed in the manufacturing sector. Yeah? People who work in McDonald's do not cook. Yeah? They assemble products. Yeah? Some of you might have been to these conveyor belt sushi restaurants, yeah? Where food actually comes to you on a conveyor belt. Yeah? Even in agriculture, you know, few people know this, but the Netherlands, despite having very little land and one of the highest population densities in the world, is the third largest exporter of agriculture. How did they achieve it? Basically, they have introduced manufacturing organizations to the management of agriculture. So computer control, time feeding, of course, combined with high quality manufacturing inputs, like the fertilizer and so on. And through that, the country has achieved very high levels of agricultural productivity. So actually, you can see how the manufacturing sector that is crucial in developing other sectors by providing the capital goods, intermediate inputs, organizational technologies. Now, many of these are reasonably widely accepted, but even many people who accept the perils of primary commodities and the benefits of manufacturing argue that, well, that still doesn't mean that you should artificially industrialize through government intervention. Focus on your comparative advantage. Do what you are relatively good at. And then other things will follow. It's actually harmful if the government tries to intervene to change the course of events. That's what Adam Smith was telling the Americans 240 years ago. And indeed, according to the conventional wisdom, such attempt to artificially industrialize is exactly what made Africa fall behind other developing countries, especially those in Asia. The so-called import substitution programs of the 1960s and 70s, where government tried to artificially industrialize the country, is what ruined the economic prospects of Africa. This is a very problematic view. First of all, there are many economic theories that can actually justify attempts to artificially industrialize through deliberate government intervention. I'm not going to go through all of these theories. Some of them are rather academic, but the most important justification for artificial industrialization is known as the theory of infant industry. The infant industry argument, or the argument that the governments in backward economies need to protect and nurture their young industries through policy measures like protectionism and subsidies until they grow up and compete with producers from more advanced countries, was actually first developed by Alexander Hamilton in that report that I mentioned. Yeah? He actually even invented the name. Yeah? This is a very simple point, but a very powerful idea. And in order to explain this, in this book that was published in 2007, I have a chapter called My 6-Year-Old Son Should Get a Job. Now, when I wrote the book, I did have a 6-year-old son. He's now almost 16, so, you know, he has that in real life grown up, but in the book, what I say is this. You know, I have this 6-year-old son who, well, I don't use such strong language in the book, but who is basically a parasite. Eh? Yeah, I mean, I pay for everything, yeah? His accommodation, his food, his healthcare, you know, education, yeah? His Nintendo games, you know. It's a very expensive proposition. Eh? And then I suddenly realized, actually, why can't he work? Yeah? No, you go to Pakistan, you go to, you know, Ecuador, you go to, you know, Rwanda, you know, there are children who work from the age of 4 or 5. You know, British children used to work from the age of 4 or 5 in the old days. Yeah, then I'll save a lot of money, yeah? Because he will be able to, you know, basically finance himself. But as I think about it more, I realize that this is actually even better than that. It's going to be a win-win solution. Because not only would I save a lot of money, he will become a very competitive person. You know, he'll be exposed to the rigors of labor market competition from a very young age. You know, no more wasting time in front of TV. No more Nintendo games. He'll have to practice his shoe shining skills and chewing gum selling skills, or windscreen wiping skills for cars. So actually, this will make him a better person. So why do I not do it? For that matter, why don't other people, especially economists who praise the benefits of competition, not do it? Now, I don't know about those guys, but you know, my reasoning at the time was, you know, he's quite a clever kid, you know. If I supported him for another, you know, 12 years, 15 years, he could become a lot of things, you know, architect, you know, nuclear physicist, you know, accountant, whatever. You know? So I'm thinking, yeah, actually it's better to give him this support for the next 12, 15 years until he can accumulate the skills, become a productive person, and then go into the adult world to, yeah, engage in full competition. Of course, there's always a chance that he will turn out to be a total waste of time. It still hasn't happened, but you know, I'm quite happy to admit that there's significant chance that this guy could be, I don't know, 33 and don't have a job and still live with me, yeah? Like Jesus Christ did. Yeah? But you know, my view is that even if there's a 50% chance that he will turn out to be like that, it's still worth supporting him, because if I kicked him into the labor market at the age of 6, what can he become? Yeah? You know, he'll start as a shoe shining boy. Maybe he'll become a, you know, street corner trader if he's really lucky and works hard and so on. Maybe he'll own a small shop. But there's no chance that he'll become an accountant or nuclear physicist. Hmm? So this is the reasoning, yeah, which is very simple but very powerful. Yeah? For the same reason why we, I mean, if we can afford it, of course, send our kids to school rather than kicking them into labor market at the age of 4 or 5, developing countries need to protect their young industries before they grow up. Yeah? It wasn't just one or two countries like the United States and South Korea that have developed on the basis of infant industry program, yeah, based on the logic of Alexander Hamilton. As I show in this book, Kicking at the Ladder, contrary to the prevailing myth, almost all of today's rich countries have developed their economies through infant industry program using measures like trade protectionism, government subsidies, regulation of private sector investment, state-owned enterprises, and public investments in things like infrastructure, education, and research and development. Of course, as the title of the book suggests, once countries become rich by using those policies, they start telling poorer countries not to use those policies. So you climb up to the top using a ladder, and when you reach the top, you kick the ladder away so that other people cannot follow. And this has been a prevalent phenomenon, but actually the expression kicking the ladder comes from Friedrich List, the 19th century German economist, who is often, although mistakenly, known as the father of the infant industry argument. I just told you that the real father is Alexander Hamilton. Huh? List wrote in his book that the British tell us the Germans and Americans, the two countries are very much identified with each other at the time, to use free trade and not to use protectionism and subsidies and so on. But when you actually look at British history, you find that they industrialized using the exact opposite of what they are recommending to other countries. Huh? So he had these passages saying, the British are actually kicking at the ladder when they recommend free trade policy to the United States and Germany. So the historical evidence is very strong. Most economic success stories have been based upon the logic of infant industry protection. But then people naturally ask, why didn't the African countries succeed with the same strategy when they tried it in the 1960s and 70s? Well, before getting into this point, I must first of all point out that the performance of the African countries during the so-called ISI period is not the disaster that it is often portrayed to be these days. Africa's growth performance has actually not too bad in those days. Per capita income in, not whole of Africa, but sub-Saharan Africa grew at 1.6% per year during the 60s and 70s. Yeah, it's not the kind of miracle rate that you want, but this is not something to be scoffed at. Yeah? This is actually higher than what the European countries and the United States achieved during the Industrial Revolution in the 19th century. So not as good as what you find in East Asia or even Latin America, but not something to laugh at. But the subsequent 20 years of structural adjustment produced far worse results. And in the 60s and 70s, per capita income in sub-Saharan Africa grew at 1.6%. In the next 20 years, it shrank at the rate of 0.7% per year. And even if you add the next 10 years, until 2010, of the rapid growth based on commodity boom, Africa's per capita income in 2010 was just 6% higher than what it was in 1980. You know, in a good year, China grows that much in half a year. Yeah? So while not trying to sell you the ISI period as some kind of the golden days, you have to put this into perspective. Yeah? Well, having said this, yes, I mean, the African the import substitution experience was not as successful as it was in countries like South Korea, Taiwan, and Japan. And I argue that there are a few reasons why this was the case. Well, first of all, there was insufficient investments in the enhancement of productive capabilities. You know, infant industry protection only creates the space in which the industries can grow. It doesn't guarantee success. Yeah? Sending your kid to school doesn't guarantee success. The kid has to study. Yeah? And you have to help him. You have to, you know, sometimes force him to study. And if infant industry program is going to be successful, there should be government policies to ensure that the necessary investments are made in raising productive capabilities. Yeah? Investment in machines, worker skills, research and development. Unfortunately, a lot of countries that kind of forgot about that, and they said, yeah, now we have created space, growth will happen. Yeah? Some growth happened, but not enough. Yeah? Secondly, there was an insufficient emphasis on exports. You know, I say that economic development is impossible without good export performance. You know, for the very simple reason that when you're a developing country, you need to have better technologies in order to develop. And where are we going to get those technologies? From technologically more advanced economies. And how are you going to get them? Well, you have to pay for them one way or another. And where are you going to get the money to pay for those things? Well, basically, you have to export whatever you have. Hmm? Yeah, some countries get some foreign aid. I mean, remittances is becoming more important. But the bulk of it has to come from your own export. So I say that export success is vital for economic development. But saying that is not the same as supporting free trade. I mean, there's a very prevalent confusion between these two. Yeah? Because export success actually requires a lot of government help. Yeah? You know, especially when it comes to small and medium-sized enterprises, breaking into export market is very difficult. Because that the significant marketing cost of quality control, sanitary and other quality requirements are from the advanced markets. So you actually need a lot of help. You know, this is why Japan set up the famous JETRO, Korea set up the famous KOTRA. Because without this kind of help, you cannot succeed in export. Yeah? This is why. For example, Denmark, when it was exporting, growing by exporting things like butter, cheese, and bacon to Britain and Germany, the government basically set up a state marketing agency to help these exporters. It also requires the government promoting the infant industries. Because yes, I mean, you might start with exporting what nature has given you, although a lot of things that people think nature has given you are actually given to you, or were given to you by the British and the French and the Spaniards. You know, from when did Kenya grow tea? When did Brazil grow coffee? You know, coffee is an African crop. So actually, a lot of your natural comparative advantage is the result of someone else's industrial policy. So there's nothing sacrosanct about them. But forgetting that issue for the moment, you start with exporting whatever you have. Fish. Coffee or whatever. But soon you will hit a barrier. Because these things are relatively easy. You know, there are dozens of countries that can produce coffee. You have to move on. You have to upgrade. And those things are not going to happen automatically. You need infant industry program. So basically what you need is a strategic combination of export promotion and infant industry program. Unfortunately, this wasn't done in many African countries, and industrialization often resulted in unsustainable balance of payment problem and the consequent macroeconomic constraints, which then put a brake on the industrialization process. Thirdly, many people have criticized the African countries during the ISI period for having had an anti-agriculture bias. This is correct, but most of the people who make this point then go on to say that therefore Africa should not have industrialized. It should have specialized in agriculture, or at least many African countries. But actually there was and still is a third way. Or rather a middle way. So a country initially has to extract investable surplus and surplus labor from the agriculture sector if it is going to industrialize. There's no denying that. But once the industrialization process gets going, it can then invest back into agriculture in the form of rural infrastructure, research, extension services, provision of modern inputs, and raise productivity in agriculture. And when the agriculture productivity rises, it will raise income in the agriculture sector, which then can provide a bigger market for the infant industries. This is what the Germans did in the 19th century. This is what the Japanese did in the 1950s and 60s. This is what the Koreans and the Chinese did in the 1970s and 80s. So there is a third way. Now, you don't have to choose completely between industry and agriculture. They can and they actually have to go together. And the last but not least, there are all those political and institutional factors that have negatively affected the policy formulation and implementation. Now, these factors are very varied across different countries, so I'm not going to make any general statement. But when you're analyzing individual countries, you will have to take these things into account. So far, I have discussed how industrialization has been the key to economic development throughout history, how it cannot happen without an active state that cooperates well with the private sector, and how the problems of Africa's ISI period were not due to the fallacy of the infant industry argument itself, but the way policies were designed and implemented. Now, even among those who accept that nationalistic industrialization strategy is the best way to develop your economy, there's an increasing concern that this option is not feasible anymore. So people have pointed out that the establishment of the WTO and the proliferation of bilateral and regional agreements on trade and investment have made this kind of industrialization model impossible. I mean, I cannot go into the detail, but the policy space has shrunken, but it's not as if there's nothing you can do. Yeah? And I sometimes joke that the WTO has become the best friend of the lazy government officials in developing countries, because when the minister tells them, well, that do this, do that, they can always say, well, minister, that's banned by the WTO. Eh? The minister is not going to go through 1,000 pages of WTO document to tell him, no, actually, you can do it. Yeah? So there are actually a lot of things that you can do. Yeah? Less than what it used to be, but there is quite a lot. Yeah? Also, people have argued that the rise of the so-called global value chains controlled by transnational corporations has made it impossible for developing country firms to enter manufacturing industries except as subcontractors to those the global corporations. However, if they are to reach high levels of economic development, developing countries need to constantly upgrade within these value chains and eventually create their own chains. Now, this is exactly what the countries like South Korea and Taiwan did. Yeah? They started from the bottom of the bottom, putting together cheap transistor radios without producing any of the parts locally. Yeah? But then over time, they acquired the ability to produce those parts, helped by government regulation on the foreign investors, on the local contents requirement, which, by the way, has become illegal in the WTO, but there are other ways to impose the increasing local contents. And gradually, they built their competencies until they become the top players in the global market. The South Korean electronics company, LG, started out as the lowest the subcontractor for the American TV company, RCA. About 10 years ago, I think the LG actually bought RCA. And this is was done not just in less foreign direct investment dependent countries like Korea and Taiwan, but also more FDI-dependent countries like China and Singapore. So you have to upgrade. At some point, you will have to create your own chain. I'm not saying this is easy, but this is how you make it. Now, finally, let me address the increasingly popular argument that developing countries don't need to industrialize anymore because now we live in a different era. We live in a post-industrial knowledge economy in which making things is not important anymore. It's something that cheap labor, poor countries do. And therefore, industrialization is not necessary. Well, those who support this argument frequently wheel out Switzerland, which is one of the richest countries in the world, despite, or in their view, rather because of its reliance on services like finance and tourism. They also frequently mention India, which has had considerable success in service exports, and it is touted as an example that shows that developing countries now can skip industrialization and become developed on the basis of services. So let me examine this argument. Let's first look at Switzerland in a slightly roundabout way. Some of you might have seen this movie, The Third Man. This is from 1949, quite an old movie. It's a movie set in the post-Second World War Vienna, and the story is essentially about the black marketeering in penicillin, yeah, which was at the time a very highly prized medicine possessed only by the United States. The movie script was written by the famous British novelist Graham Greene, who later turned it into a novel. But apparently there's the one dialogue, or in this case the monologue, which was written by the leading actor, Orson Welles, who in the movie appears as this evil guy called Harry Lime. Yeah? When Harry Lime is confronted by his friend, this guy in the hat, he launches himself into this diatribe in which he basically tries to argue that evil is good. Yeah? So the way he does it is this. Yeah? In Italy, for 30 years, under the Borgias, they had all the bad things about human nature: warfare, terror, murder, bloodshed, but they gave us the Renaissance. Huh? In Switzerland, they had brotherly love, 500 years of democracy and peace, and what did they produce? The cuckoo clock. Huh? Now, the amazing thing is that these two last sentences, yeah, in Switzerland and the cuckoo clock, these two sentences contain no less than 5 falsehoods. This must be some kind of record, yeah? Falsehood per word, yeah? Let me tell you how. Well, 500 years of democracy, you know, I don't know about other people, but I don't call a country a democracy if half the population cannot vote. Yeah? The Swiss gave women vote only in 1971. Actually, if you count these two rogue cantons which refused to give voting rights to women in local elections, Switzerland became full democracy only in 1991. Hmm? So this democracy is only 25 years old, not 500 years old. Hmm? 500 years of peace, well, not quite true. They had a few spats with neighbors. Same story with 500 years of brotherly love. They actually had no less than 4 civil wars in a span of 200 years. So where is that brotherly love? Yeah? And the cuckoo clock was not invented in Switzerland. It was invented in Germany. Finally, Switzerland is not an economy living off the black money deposited by third world dictators and selling tacky souvenirs like cuckoo clocks and cowbells to American and Japanese tourists, or if you want to be nice to it, a model post-industrial economy relying on services like banking and tourism. It is actually one of the most industrialized economies in the world. Actually, literally, at the moment, it is the most industrialized economy in the world. Yeah? On per capita basis, it produces more manufacturing output than anyone in the world. 86% more than the Americans, 8 times, or nearly 9 times more than China, the supposed workshop of the world. Of course, you don't see many made in Switzerland products, partly because it's a small country, but also because it specializes in what economists call producer goods. Yeah? Machines, you know, precision equipment, industrial chemical. So you think they don't make anything. Yeah? No, on per capita basis, it makes, you know, so much. Another interesting fact is that Singapore, which is another country that is often touted as a model of the post-industrial the knowledge economy, it's the second most industrialized country in the world. Yeah? How about India then? Well, India had success in service trade, but it has been highly exaggerated. Until 2003, India didn't even have trade surplus in services. It started having surplus only in 2004. And I mean, this is the latest data I could find. I mean, between 2004 and 11, India recorded the service trade surplus equivalent only to 0.9% of GDP, which covered only 17% of its merchandise trade deficit, which amounted to 5.1% of GDP. So this means that unless it increases its service trade surplus by six times, this is a totally implausible scenario, India cannot maintain its current pace of economic development without a serious balance of payment problems. So why is the discourse of post-industrial knowledge economies so resoundingly refuted by the very countries that it sells as its model cases, namely Switzerland, Singapore, India? I argue that it is because the discourses are theoretically very weak. Let me just point out a few key points. First of all, I should have shown you this earlier. First of all, we have actually always lived in a knowledge economy. You know, it was never the act of making things, but the control over the superior productive knowledge that has been the key to economic prosperity. So there's nothing new about knowledge becoming being important. Also, many knowledge-intensive services like research, engineering, design that are supposed to be new have always been there. I mean, only that they used to be conducted by the manufacturing companies themselves. Recently, there have been a lot of outsourcing and offshoring of these activities. So you think these are all new activities, but these are things that manufacturing companies themselves used to do, most of them. Thirdly, and as I mentioned earlier, the manufacturing sector has been the main source of new productive knowledge. I'm just summarizing the points here again. You know, just to give you another example, you know, the recent rise in productivity in the services sector has happened mainly because they are now using more advanced inputs produced by the manufacturing sector. Computers, fiber optics, routers, GPS machines, more fuel-efficient cars, down to mechanized warehouses. These are all inputs produced by the manufacturing sector. Last but not least, all those supposedly knowledge-intensive services like finance, design, engineering, and so on sell mostly to manufacturing firms. So their success depends on manufacturing success. Of course, countries can specialize in the export of those services, but over time they are likely to lose their competitiveness in those services because they need close interaction with the customers in the manufacturing sector in order to improve their quality and productivity. So there's a limit to how much you can be a totally specialized services exporter, even if they are high value services. Okay, so let me wind up. In this lecture, I have discussed why Africa needs industrialization for economic development and why that requires an effective industrial policy. And I have also shown how all those arguments against Africa's industrialization are very weak, both theoretically and empirically. Of course, today I could speak only in very general terms. I couldn't give you enough examples. But I hope what I have said today have made you think that the case for industrializing Africa is very strong. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Ha Jun Chang, there for that very insightful, insightful lecture. Now, because of time, we only have time to take a few questions. We're going to have to wrap up in about 10 or 15 minutes or so. I've got lots of questions, but I don't have the luxury of asking them, so because this is your time to ask the questions. So if you could just, of course, use the microphones that are at your disposal and state your name. And please ask a very brief question. Make it shorter than the answer so that we can get through quite a bit. The gentleman there with his hand at the back there, who are you and what's your question, sir?
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Deniz Kelecioglu, economist at ECA. I fully concur with all the findings and conclusions of your research. Thank you, Professor. Just want to highlight two points. One about, correct me if I'm wrong, but Korea in particular had the backing of Japan in its industrialization process, and Japan had the backing of USA. This is not the case for African economic history. So I wonder what you make of that, because Africa has received more kicking away the ladder rather than helping with the ladder, which was the case with Korea. The second point, I mean, despite all the brilliant policy recommendations, the trick is to convince or capacity the governance structures and mechanisms to actually embark on this type of policy recommendations. So what would you recommend for us to, for the governance structures to actually care about these policy recommendations and actually embark on them? Thank you.
Professor, shall we take two more questions and you can answer them all at once? Who's got another question? This gentleman here on the third row to my right.
My name is Ayo Olukoni. I'm a retired Nigerian Foreign Service officer and I'm a pensioner. I'm looking forward to be involved in industrialization. And I want to ask you, among within the framework of the various factors of production, what and what do you think is very key and very important for us in Africa now? And considering the fact that the whole question of push, that the services sector, the IT revolution, is creating more opportunities, is better than going to industrialization. I mean, the key issue among all the factors of production, in context of where we are today, what and what do you think we will identify as most important?
And finally, sir, I saw you raise your hand over there on the left.
Thank you very much indeed. Now, I heard, Mr. Professor.
Sir, identify yourself, please, sir.
Hamid Tamar. I am consultant to ECA and professor, retired professor, as a matter of fact. So I thank you very much, Mr. Professor. But I heard very much what you said in the sense that you are telling us what the African countries should not do. They should be very prudent about all these new ideas which are coming up against many problems and mainly about protections and so on. But I didn't hear really something which is concrete in terms of what we have to do to industrialize the country. The very first point to my mind is the industrialization is not industry. Putting together industry is not industrializing. The industrializing is going through the society changed progressively to absorb industry. And that's the whole matter about industrializing a country. Secondly, to my mind, the strategy, substitution industry strategy in itself means protection, no doubt about that. I come from a country, Algeria, where this sort of policy has been put together. And we had new infant industries. As you have said, we should put together and set these industries, but at the same time, promote them by giving them technology, training, and so on. All that has been done by Algeria. It didn't succeed. And our infant industries are 60 years, infant industries, as you said. So, undoubtedly, I mean, everything has been done, but it didn't happen. I mean, it's only when finally the country opened up and decided to go globalization that we saw something changing within the country. And that put in the picture something that you are probably, you didn't allude for at all, is FDI. I do believe, having been a minister for industrialization of my country, I do believe that we can't industrialize our countries without FDI. The problem is, if you put FDIs and let them do whatever they do, without precisely, as China did, as a matter of fact, taking all the measure to surround them by SMEs and trying to promote SMEs to go with the FDIs, then probably we can see something which can emerge little by little and having industries. Is so what Korea did, by the way.
I'm going to have to interrupt
yes,
you. That's
I stop. I come to the last point, really. It's very important indeed. To my mind, from my experience, the point which should be emphasized is governance. It's undoubtedly when governance is right, when the institution framework is right, that we can probably see something emerging in our countries in terms of industrialization. Thank you very much indeed.
Professor, before you answer, three questionnaires, several questions there. I think it would help us if you just summarize the question as you go along before you answer it.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, there have been lots of questions. I mean, some of them overlap. So, you know, one question was that whether, you know, that I mean, Africa can replicate the East Asian experience when the East Asian countries had a special dispensation from the United States. Another is asked by many people the question of governance, and then there was a question as to exactly how you choose the sectors and the factors of production necessary for those sectors. And then, yeah, I mean, how you make sure that protection works, how you use FDI. So I'll answer them very, very briefly. Yes, I mean, a lot of people have argued that, you know, the countries like Korea and Japan had a lot of special dispensation from the United States. I mean, this is partly true. For example, in the 1950s, without U.S. aid, the Korean economy probably would have collapsed. On the other hand, when you think about it, being the frontier state of the Cold War put a very heavy burden on countries like Korea and Taiwan. Yeah? I mean, these countries were spending during the Cold War 6% of GDP on defense when the international average is about 2.5%. Yeah? So it came with a very heavy price tag. Yeah? And also that there were all these arguments that, you know, the U.S. gave special market access to Korea and Taiwan. I haven't seen anyone producing any evidence for that. But, you know, even if it was there to an extent, you know, in other areas, it's not as if, you know, the U.S. gave us carte blanche, you know, we had to play a lot of strategic game, you know, give huge lip service to free market economy while doing other things, you know. So that, I mean, I take the point, but its importance that shouldn't be exaggerated. On the question of governance, yes, I mean, governance is crucial, you know, South Korea in the 1950s, you know, had very similar structural conditions from South Korea in the 1960s and 70s, but, you know, it didn't do well because of, you know, governance reasons. But, you know, I really caution people against believing that you first have to sort out the governance before you can do anything. Yeah? Well, first of all, it's going to take a couple of hundred years, yeah, to do that. No, seriously, in my book, in Kicking Out the Ladder, I show how low quality the institutions and governance was in today's rich countries in the 19th century when they were industrializing. To give you just one example, until 1883, not a single employee of the US federal government was recruited through competitive process. Yeah? Can you believe it? I mean, which country does that today? Yeah? Even in the countries which are supposed to have, you know, the worst governance practice, yeah? At least they'll pretend that it's competitive. Yeah? No, in the U.S., there's not even the pretense. Eh? So that this will take a long time. And secondly, quality of governance interacts with your level of economic development and industrialization and all the social changes that industrialization brings with it. Yeah? So actually, when you kickstart industrialization, it will have a beneficial effect on the governance itself. Yeah? So you have to see it as a two-way process. Yeah? I mean, very often people say, well, nothing can happen in country X, country Y, until they completely sort out the corruption problem, you know, this problem, that problem. That way, you will never do anything. You know, it's like driving a shit car. Yeah? It breaks down all the time. Yeah? But are you then going to say, well, okay, we'll park the car in this and stop the race and, I don't know, grow vegetables, earn money, 30 years later we'll buy a good car and join the race, then it'll be too late. Yeah? You'll have to drive this car while fixing it as best as you can, while doing some side jobs to earn money to trade it in for a better car, you know, that 50 kilometers down the road. And I mean, I think you have to see this governance issue. Yeah? I mean, I cannot emphasize the importance of governance issues more. Yeah? I mean, I have written a lot about institutions and development, yeah? But you have to see it as an interactive process, not something that you sort out before you do anything. Yeah? How do you choose sectors? Well, at the lowest level, there are some obvious things. You know, if you have certain types of mineral resources or natural resources, you start with those. Yeah? This is why Finland started with logging, Sweden having a lot of iron ore started with making iron and then steel. But sooner or later, you will have to go beyond your natural endowments. Yeah? And my view is that countries become, when it comes to sort of higher level things, countries become good at certain things only because they want to become good at certain things. Yeah, just that. Give me one reason why the Japanese should be good at making cars. Yeah? Why the Koreans should be making good at good at making cars. Yeah? No, Americans, you can understand. You know, they have a lot of land. You know, they have to go from A to B. You know, quickly. They need good transport. Yeah? In Korea and Japan, we don't even have land to drive around. Yeah? And why have we become good at making cars? Only because we decided that we will become good at making cars. Yeah? And in the beginning, it was a joke. Yeah? When Hyundai, the Korean motor company, first started this assembly of a complete knockdown kit from Ford in the 1960s, it produced 6 cars a day. You know, it was a glorified garage. Yeah? I still remember, in 1977, when I was 14, there were big headlines in Korean newspapers saying Korea exports its first cars. Turns out that we sold 6 cars to Ecuador. Eh? We probably paid them to buy the cars. Eh? But we have persisted, yeah? Invested, raised productivity, and that's how we became good at making cars. Eh? So once you depart a little bit from your natural base, then it's really up to you. You know, why did Finland move from logging and paper making to electronics? Yeah? It was a strategic choice. Yeah? So once again, I'm not trying to give you any illusion. You know, I mean, you have to start with the lowest things, yeah? Things that you can do well now. Yeah? But you have to have a plan. Yeah? In 20 years' time, 30 years' time, we'll become good at, I don't know, pharmaceuticals or machine tools or medical equipment. Yeah? And in the meantime, you have to invest in those things. Yeah? You have to buy the right machines, train the right engineers, yeah? Set up the right research institute, so that when the time comes, you can become good at those things. Yeah? And as for the question about protection not producing any result, yeah, I mean, once again, I'll go back to the analogy with child rearing. Yeah? You know, you have to have a plan. Yeah? I mean, you cannot say, I'm going to give you subsidy until you die. Yeah? No, that wouldn't work. Yeah? So you have to sit down with the private sector work out a plan. You know, this is where you are. We are going to give you this much support. Do you think you can deliver this much in 20 years' time, 15 years' time? Yeah. In 5 years' time, you'll have to do these things to convince us that you are moving in the right direction. In 15 years' time, you'll have to deliver these results. Yeah, and then you'll come up with some kind of plan for kind of graduated reduction in tariffs. Yeah, it's just the same as raising children. Yeah? You initially protect them totally. Yeah? And then you begin to give them more responsibilities. You begin to demand more performance from them. Yeah? Until one day you will say, now you're on your own. Yeah? So I think that kind of strategy is necessary. And finally, I mean, I can agree with you more on point of the illusion of technological self-sufficiency. Yeah? It's an illusion. Yeah? It's, look at North Korea. Yeah? It has been technologically self-sufficient for the last 70 years. But how many technologies they have invented that they can call totally their own? I say one. Yeah? They invented this synthetic fiber out of limestone called vinalon. Yeah, this is a pretty cool achievement. Yeah? But all the rest of the technologies they use are basically 1930s Japanese technologies and 1950s Soviet technology. Yeah? This is a total illusion that you can have technological self-sufficiency. You have to learn from other countries. Yeah? But as the minister said, I mean, you have to have a strategy to absorb these technologies. Yeah? When you are accepting foreign investment, you have to have a strategy to increase localization, train local labor, eventually acquire the technological capabilities. If you don't do that, you become like Sri Lanka. Yeah? Of course, the country suffered from the civil war and all that, but Sri Lanka actually started export processing zone before South Korea and Taiwan. In the 1950s, huh? Where is it now? It's still got that $2,000-$3,000 per capita income, whereas Korea and Taiwan has the income 10 times that, yeah? Because they just accepted foreign direct investment, did the assembly job, didn't upgrade, yeah? Whereas Koreans and the Taiwanese, they upgraded, yeah? Invested, and created their own companies, huh? Okay, I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much for your help. Professor Chang there. Professor Chang's lecture will be available on the UNECA website in soft copy, so please go to the site and also circulate it amongst people. I know you know a lot of people that would be interested, that are not here, that should really hear what you just heard. And also, you will get another opportunity to ask him questions and engage with him, because after lunch, Professor Chang will be launching his new book. It's this one, isn't it? Transformative Industrial Policy for Africa. After lunch, please join him for that. There'll be a Q&A session. I guess all that remains now is for me to first of all thank Mr. Doyin Adedeji, representing his father, Adebayo Adedeji. This is the lecture, the 2016 Adebayo Adedeji lecture. Also, Dr. Lopez, thank you for your introductory remarks. And I guess if I could ask you, Professor, to please stand and be recognized as the guest speaker for the Adebayo Adedeji 2016 lecture. Ladies and gentlemen.